Over the years, we have seen so many good takes and predictions in NASCAR, and it's something that really should be commended. This is not a video that's going to do that. Instead, this is a video that's going to look at the complete polar opposite, the dumbest NASCAR takes ever. Now, I want to say before I read this off that I'm not doing this to hate on anyone in particular. I wanted to get people's perspectives and opinions on that and kind of see where others are coming from with it. It doesn't mean that I think that the commenters are right or wrong. I'll give my take or whatever on what little bit that I think about it, but at the same time, it is something that's a lot of food for thought. So on my community tab a couple days ago, I left this comment. I said, "What are the dumbest NASCAR takes or opinions in the sport's history that you can remember?" And you guys, again, didn't disappoint. This is about the third or fourth video we've done like this, and I want to just read some of these great and really fun takes today that you guys have. So without further ado, let's get to it. The first comment is from Rudy K, who says, "Steve Phelps nearly about to double down on the 550 horsepower high downforce package, saying it was the best racing ever. The racing was slow and dirty air was the only thing to talk about, watching them struggle to pass. Basically, mini pack racing, which no racing fan wants to see at 1.5 to 2 mile tracks. Can't believe we almost got to go through another generation of cars with that awful package." Now, I will say, I don't think this was strictly a Steve Phelps deal. I think he's the front man to NASCAR leadership as a whole. And while I've been supportive of a lot of their takes, the 550 horsepower package is definitely not one of those. And I gotta say that I will give NASCAR credit on this one. There was so much feedback from fans, drivers, and whoever else that once they had an actual superior product in the 670 package, they did at least change that. And I'll say that's something that probably wouldn't have happened with Brian France leading the charge. Nolan Davis says, "I remember back in 2008 when Kyle Busch went to Gibbs, there were a lot of people saying he was going to be a bust because he got booted from Hendrick. Boy, were they wrong." I agree with that. They were certainly wrong. But as someone who did remember a lot of what happened back then, I can tell you that was a real take a lot of people had. And there was some credence to it. Kyle Busch had won only a couple of races in his time at Hendrick Motorsports. While not being as bad as guys like Brian Vickers or as bad as Casey Mears, he still wasn't setting the world on fire compared to his teammates Jeff Gordon and Jimmy Johnson. So when he went to what seemed to be a less superior team in Gibbs, yeah, I can see where people came from with it. Plus, that 18 car was dreadful for the years leading up to 2008. From 2004 to 2007, they did not win a single race, and they weren't even close to being legitimate championship contenders. So when Kyle Busch came in and set the world on fire, it really was a shock to a lot of people, though a lot of industry insiders probably did see that coming. Patrick Heidman says that Richard Petty and David Pearson were not good because they had OP equipment back in the day. Like, look at F1, for example. There have been many times where Hamilton has driven through the field to the lead and Bottas has run top five at best in the exact same equipment. But you don't win 200 times in any sport without being one of the best or even the GOAT. I'd like to agree with this one here. I think that revisionist history has really diminished how good that drivers were back in the day, like Richard Petty and David Pearson. Petty and Pearson were the best of their era, and if you try to argue that, I'm sorry, you're arguing a losing battle. So, yes, they had better equipment than a lot of other drivers did, but you know what? They took advantage of that equipment. When you look, for instance, at the modern day, Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon are the two most recent drivers to have long dominant stints in NASCAR, where they were the guy to beat and they won championships and races year in and year out. And it's not just because they had what was probably the best equipment, but also because they were the drivers who could take advantage of it. When Jeff Gordon was dominating, his teammates weren't nearly as good. I like what you're saying, Patrick, and I agree. Richard Petty and David Pearson had great equipment, but they were great drivers too, and they should be remembered as such. PapaDragon69 says, "NASCAR died with Dale Sr. is the dumbest statement ever." And for the most part, I agree with it. NASCAR as it was with Dale Earnhardt, yes, did end with Dale Sr. But at the same time, NASCAR did pretty damn well even after his passing. I mean, it wasn't like NASCAR peaked out at 2001 and then went down from there. They went for another 5 years of great ratings, and it took about another decade after their peak to get down to 2001 and 2000 levels again. So it's not like NASCAR has absolutely been awful without Dale Sr. There have been great moments, and people I think who say this are people who really were more Dale Sr. fans than actual full-on NASCAR fans. Isaac the Civil One says, I'm about to clown myself. I thought Riley Herbst was going to be decent in the 98 and 2021. What an idiot I was to have any faith in Roadblock Herbst. All right, well, to be fair, I didn't think he was going to be great, but I thought with the 98 team and how good they were the year previously, that Herbst would at least probably win one race and be up front a little more. And the first half of the season, he was utterly embarrassing to watch on track. Darlington is the big one that comes to mind for me, where he was just a roadblock and in the wall and basically a hazard, a moving chicane. But you see, I will give him credit. By the end of the year, he was running up in the top 10, and even at races like Bristol, for instance, the top 5, and showed a lot of speed and growth. Now, I'm not saying that he was good by any means for what that team standards were in 2020 compared to 2021, but what I'm saying is he has gotten better. 48 Nation says he won't win the damn war. MTJ. Yeah. Logano won the damn war, and to add insult to injury, it was Martin Truex Jr. that he had to battle and pass to win that. Marco Flores says, Bruton Smith saying Kentucky would be the biggest race in NASCAR. He ain't lying. Bruton Smith actually claimed this. He claimed that Kentucky would be right up there with Daytona and bigger than the Brickyard and the Coke 600. And a little over a decade later, the track is dormant. Yeah. I'd say that was probably one of the biggest horrid takes in NASCAR history, and I'm so surprised that so many people have forgotten about this one. Jingle Octopus saying Kevin LePage saying it was the other driver's fault they didn't move out of the way when he almost killed everyone. Yeah, that was really awful. I get being embarrassed that you made that bad of a mistake, and you know deep down he was. But blaming it on everyone else on national television in front of 2 to 3 million people just made you look even worse. I mean, that's literally like getting caught with your hand in the cookie jar. Nah, let's be real, not hand in the cookie jar. You shattered the cookie jar on the ground on video camera and then saying that your brother did it. Like, seriously, dude, we all saw you do it. Rowdy Major 18 says, the fact that NASCAR fans hate certain drivers like Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon, and soon to be Kyle Larson because they win too much. Isn't the whole point of being a race car driver and in competition to be better than everyone else? I never understood that way of thinking. In any other sport, winning is praised, but in NASCAR, if a driver wins too much, it's a bad thing. Yeah, this is something I think that really separates a lot of NASCAR fans from both other racing fans and a lot of sports fans. He is right. When you look at other sports, generally the ones who are voted or are shown in sales to be the most popular athletes are the ones that win. In the NFL for a long time, it was Peyton Manning and Tom Brady. Now there's guys like Patrick Mahomes and Russell Wilson. But in NASCAR, it's different. When Jeff Gordon started winning in the 90s all the time because he didn't fit the mold that people liked, suddenly they hated him. But then, when he stopped winning, he was a really popular driver again while Jimmy Johnson was hated. You see it with Kyle Busch, you see it with Kevin Harvick, you saw it with Carl Edwards at times. Whoever wins just a little bit too much really gets an eye roll from a lot of fans. And you are going to see it with Kyle Larson if he keeps winning like he did last year. Southeast Cup Series, putting that people saying NASCAR is a dead sport, even with millions of people watching a week. Yeah, I do find that kind of funny that the kind of ESPN drone types are the ones who are saying that NASCAR is dead, even though generally outside of the NFL, NASCAR outperforms just about every other sport still at its dead period. Let's be real, there's not much credence to this thought. Yeah, it's not as popular as it once was, but it's still pretty damn popular when you compare it to a lot of other things. Riptide says, NASCAR is just hillbillies driving in circles. I read this as a fan from Illinois who's lived in the Midwest his entire life. Just saying. NASCAR is awesome, but one of the dumbest things people do is compare F1 to NASCAR. They aren't really anything alike and shouldn't be compared to the point that they are. Two different series with two different goals, reach, and overall racing. But That's one of the reasons people like the series, because they're playing different. Yeah, I used to be one of those fans who would think that NASCAR was superior to open wheel, or hear from other fans that open wheel was superior to NASCAR and getting those stupid fights. And they're very easy to get into because a lot of different racing fans have a lot of disrespect for other racing series. I remember, for instance, when I wore a NASCAR hat to a dirt race back around 2016 or 17, and I got a lot of crap from dirt fans saying that it wasn't as good a racing or wasn't real racing. I just was going to a dirt race for the first time. That was a pretty rude awakening to how some fans view asphalt racing. So it goes both ways, but I will say what I like is that a lot of younger fans are starting to like just racing overall. You don't see as many younger fans nowadays being strictly NASCAR fans or strictly IndyCar or F1 or dirt racing fans. There's a lot more diversity in what racing palette they have, so it is starting to change. It's just going to take some time. David G saying 2014, Casey Kane getting penalized in the 500 for speeding on pit road to avoid a wreck. And he pretty much puts it as is. There was a wreck coming up right behind Casey Kane. He guns it, gets on pit road too fast, doesn't really gain anything on anyone, and then is penalized for it because if he didn't do it, he would have gotten crashed. It was pretty plain and easy to see for the most part. And then hearing the broadcast be like, well, you know, it sucks, but the rules are the rules, really also rubbed dirt in a lot of people's faces. Dylan says people still making fun of Juan Pablo Montoya for hitting the jet dryer as if it was his fault the car broke at the worst possible time. Clowning on a world-class driver for no reason. This is one that I absolutely agree with. Yes, the jet dryer jokes can be funny. I would be lying to you if I said I haven't made a few myself over the years. But I do have the distinction of knowing and making it clear it was not Juan Pablo Montoya's fault. If anything, it was his crew and crew chief's fault for sending him back out on track relatively fast in a broken vehicle. The car, like Dylan said, broke at the exact wrong time. He flew into the jet dryer, and the rest is history. And that's it. Those are what you guys put as the dumbest opinions and takes that have been seen in recent NASCAR history. And I gotta say, those are some really fun ones, but I'm sure that commenters and myself left out a lot of them. So now it's up to you watching right now. Leave your thoughts in the comments down below on what was the dumbest take you've ever seen in NASCAR. While you're at it, leave a like in this video. Share this video and subscribe to my channel for more great NASCAR content. Thank you to all my channel members for your continued support. And until next time, have a good one.